Well, hello, everyone. And I want to welcome you here to St. Timothy Lutheran Church. I'm Pastor Jennifer Michael, the pastor here. And I want to remind you today, we welcome you here to celebrate the life of Janet McCarthy. Now, each of us will die someday, and each of us shall die for only one reason, and that's because we have lived. Life is from God, and you are not here because someone died. You're here because someone who is very special to you lived, and lived robustly. What binds us all together is that common sorrow we share, because each one of you was touched by this life, impacted by this life, and loved this woman deeply. So let us remember that as we center our hearts for worship. Welcome, everyone. Please rise as you are able and face the baptismal font. Welcome in the name of Jesus, the Savior of the world. We are gathered to worship, to proclaim Christ crucified and risen, to remember before God our sister Janet, to give thanks for her life, to commend her to our merciful Redeemer, and to comfort one another in our grief. When we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead, by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him in death, in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. Let us pray. God of grace and glory,
We remember before you today our sister Janet. We thank you for giving her to us to know and to love as a companion in our pilgrimage on earth. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see that death has been swallowed up in the victory of our Lord Jesus Christ, so that we may live in confidence and hope until, by your call, we are gathered to our heavenly home in the company of all your saints. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Amen.
When I was asked to speak about a memory or two that I shared with Janet, I couldn't think of anything without thinking of something else that led to something else and led to something else. And over 42 years, the memories of Janet have spanned from the earliest memories to my very most recent. It is hard to think of one single memory when it comes to Janet, because she was a lifetime in racing. It was a celebration of birthdays and holidays, waking up on Christmas mornings with her, receiving postcards from her many travels, and being by my side through the loss of friends and family, and getting to return the favor after Joe passed away by being by her side. During my first deployment, Janet gave me a small box, and inside it was a necklace of hers with three charms on it. The charms read faith, hope, and love. She asked that I carry it with me, and I did. Every hard day or hard mission, I would find myself pulling the box out to help me remember that I was loved and that I was missed. Her presence in my life was always her gift to me. It was a gift she was willing to give to me, also to my children. One of my favorite memories of Janet was getting to watch her play with Addison. Madeline and Nash. Janet would often fly in for a couple weeks at a time and stay with Mom and Dad at least every other month, or maybe sometimes more than that. And during her many visits, one of the many things that she would do for the kids was bring them her snacks from the airplane. And as simple as that was, that made them feel very special. But instead of just giving them their snacks, the kids always wanted to play airplane. The kids would line up dining room chairs in rows and then board the plane with their luggage and give the attendant their tickets, and departing to their destination, usually Disney World, Janet would then get to read them the safety briefing and show them how to buckle their seatbelts. Papa would usually get to be the pilot and point out all the highlights of the flight, and Grandma would get to prepare this special in-flight meal. But Janet had the responsibility of giving them their special snacks. Sometimes she had to deal with a pretty disgruntled passenger when I was allowed to play. She probably wished the FAA would allow her to carry a taser on those flights. We would sometimes play this game with the same snacks and the same general ritual when she was not in town. But it was never the same, because Janet's presence always made it extra special. I was told the other day how special it was from a grandparent's perspective to get to watch your kids grow up all over again for your grandchildren. Janet may not have been a grandmother, but she was one of the greatest aunts anyone could have ever asked for. and I always enjoyed getting to watch her give Addison, Madeline, and Nash the same amount of faith, hope, and love that she gave me for so many years.
Aunt Janet, Aunt Ned, Aunt Turd, whatever it is that we called her, she was ours. You should all understand that having an aunt who never had children of her own was bound to be a special aunt. She loved us as she would have loved her own children. Her laugh was distinct and contagious, and most things we all said were just too funny. One thing I especially loved and admired about her was that she didn't speak to us like we were small children. She respected us in a way that I always really appreciated. We would have cousin slumber parties at Janet's. It was always full of time together and laughter, but we weren't eating Kraft mac and cheese at Janet's sleepovers. Nope, she would introduce us to things like caprese. I felt pretty sophisticated as a kid enjoying caprese, and to this day, when my husband and children ask for fresh mozzarella, basil, and fresh-grown tomatoes, I think of Janet. Janet spent her career days as a flight attendant, as you all know. She might as well have been Mrs. Claus because she got to see the world. She would bring us treats from other countries, and I will never forget the excitement when I heard she was visiting Germany. Do you know what comes from Germany? Well, as I'm reading this aloud, my oldest daughter, Emmeline, was my audience, and she said, Spätzle. But the correct answer is Kinder eggs. The original, delicious, hollow egg with milk chocolate on the outside, white chocolate lining the inside, and a toy right in the middle. Now, it's apparently too dangerous to put a toy in the middle of a Kinder Egg, and they're just not the same, but loved just as much by my own children. The return trip from Germany with the Kinder Egg might as well have been Christmas for us because it was one of my favorite things Janet brought home. From beauty shops that she, Ma, and Aunt Joni created for us, to the Santa Claus collection she built for me by gifting one each year from her adventures around the world, Janet truly loved us, and we knew it. Over the years, as we all created lives apart from our parents, aunts, and uncles, Janet did not distance herself from her nieces and nephews. Surprise packages appeared at each holiday. Texts would be exchanged and life updates given. My children would look forward to what Aunt Janet would send in the package. Fun activities, treats, and of course, her fresh grown lemons from her lemon tree. I could continue on and on about fond memories of our Aunt Janet, but I think we all know what a special treasure she was to all of us in different ways. We will always hold a special place in our hearts for her, and I rejoice in knowing that she is free from earthly pain and sorrow. Give your dad and Uncle Joe the biggest hug from all of those, from all of us still Earthside. We love you.
I think we're all here today for the same reason, but our hearts and memories are all telling different stories. One thing that we all share is that we are unique in our life experiences, our appearances, and in our purposes. Can we all agree that Janet was somewhat unique? A person who was terrified of heights, loved to soar above the clouds. A person who had no children, loved nothing more than to spoil children. She called her nephews and nieces her own. A person who loved family and holidays, chose to work on holidays so that others could be with their families. A person who was afraid of dogs. Well, she never learned to love dogs. Janet was Janet. I only knew Janet for 51 of her 66 years, but Janet was known to be Janet. Stories of a tow-headed, independent, creative little girl who, with her friend Courtney down the street, had the Weeping Willow Beauty Salon beside the lake. The tiny girl who skied with her brothers, Matt and Stephen, and her sister, Joni, and many cousins for miles upon miles of Old Hickory Lake. The Janet, who was clearly not a morning person, usually became pleasant as the day progressed. When Joni and I began dating in 1972, Janet and I formed a bond. My memories of her included her demonstrated love for family, sharing time with cousins on the boat dock, swimming in the lake, and hearing stories about her times with Uncle Junior, Granny and Granddaddy Hagwood, and times with Martha and Tati, James and Juana, and all the cousins she loved. You may remember her family presented a patriotic show all across the United States. Janet's solo performance was a rendition of 5'2", Eyes of Blue. Of course, she had brown eyes, but you had to use your imagination. Janet loved relationships and was loved by others, especially after she had her coffee. Janet had a lot of talent. She loved theater, having been active in several productions in school and later in the Nashville theater community. On her last visit with us, she wanted to see White Christmas. That was her favorite musical of the season. So we found tickets and we were off to the theater. And when the actors sang the song Sisters, I suddenly realized that I was that mister who came between Janet and her sister. I remember teaching Janet how to drive a car with a manual transmission. That was an experience. I remember driving with Jane to bring Janet home from her time at Uppsala College in New Jersey. And she had her upstairs apartment packed and ready to go, so we had been told before we drove to New Jersey. And when we got there, Jane and I washed her dishes, packed her belongings, loaded them in the car, and drove her back to Tennessee. Another of Janet's adventures was serving as a tour guide at the Tennessee State Capitol, and that was a job she really loved. After a couple of other career moves, Janet somehow became interested in becoming a flight attendant. And again, it just didn't make sense to me for someone who was afraid of heights for Janet to choose this career path. But this was Janet. She became her daddy's favorite child when he was able to use Janet's flying privileges. He still loved her even when she always ate the point off of every piece of cake or slice of pie that he was served. Because, you see, he could fly for free. Now recently, when she was with us, we took a day trip to an apple orchard up on the plateau and ate at a restaurant. Joni, Janet, and I all had apple cake for dessert. Immediately, she took her fork, and before I could have my first bite, she took the point off of my piece of cake, and I didn't even have flying privileges. Janet loved her nieces and nephews, Daniel, Dustin, Kara, Lindsay, young Matt, as she called him, Stevie, and Carly. She considered them her own children. When the nieces and nephews married and had children of their own, Janet became the grandmother, actually the obnoxious grandmother. She pulled out pictures of Kara's kids, Lindsay's kids, Stevie's and Carly's children. She even showed us pictures of our own grandkids, and she had stories to tell each time. With each picture came stories. With each visit came more pictures and more stories. You see, she was proud. If you've ever tried to contact Janet, you know she didn't always answer her phone, and she was really bad about responding to text messages. But there was one thing for certain. She was always available at 11 o'clock a.m. on Saturday to answer young Matt's phone call. That was a highlight of her week. Her first airline experience was with Piedmont Airlines. She was off to Charlotte, North Carolina. Piedmont then became U.S. Airways, and Janet was based in Philadelphia, where she made a host of friends. Later, her career landed her in Phoenix, the place she seemed to claim as home for many years. Again, Janet found friends who became her family. She loved her church there, was involved in her book club, ladies' groups, and loved hiking, bicycling, and traveling with the love of her life, Joe. When Janet met Joe, her life changed. Suddenly, she had an incessant smile and new energy. Since both worked in the airline industry, their lives shared the same interests. They had the same friends, and both loved to entertain. And Janet found true happiness. Both Janet and Joe worked in the airline's training facility and took pride in their roles at U.S. Airways. Here they made more friends, welcoming what they called new hires into their home and encouraged them to become passionate about the airline industry just as they were. And I must tell you that the airline family and their neighbors and her neighbors have been unbelievably supportive during this time. We've received calls, texts, and help from those people whose lives were impacted by Janet. Her friend and coworker for many years, Rhett, was very kind to share comments that were posted on the airline's flight attendant closed group Facebook page. Page after page of comments were posted as a tribute to Janet. More often than not, when Janet's name was mentioned, Joe's name was mentioned in the same sentence. You see, Janet wasn't Janet. She was Janet and Joe. Theirs was a beautiful story. Upon Joe's death, Janet never found a way to fill the deep hole in her soul. The chasm was just far too deep. Janet searched for happiness. She visited our home often and for extended periods, and upon each visit, she would discuss her plans to move near family back to Tennessee, back home. She would look at property in Tennessee. In fact, during her last visit just weeks ago, she said, I could get used to this, concerts, ball games, plays. And Janet even suggested to Daniel that she could just put a tiny house in his backyard. That wasn't going to happen. But when she left our house on the 11th of November, she told us that she would need us to pick her up at the airport in Nashville on November the 23rd. You see, Janet wanted both families, her family in Tennessee and her family in Arizona. She had great memories and a host of people who loved her in both places. All who loved her knew not to speak until she had enough coffee to transport herself from a sleepy ogre to a warm, caring, generous person that she really was. It became obvious that Janet could never have enough coffee to find the happiness she had experienced with Joe, not in Tennessee, nor in Arizona. On behalf of her mother, Jane, Joni, Matt, and Stephen, I want to thank you for being here today to celebrate the life of a beautiful person. When you look into the sky and when you see contrails that are left by jets, think of Janet. Know that she loved flowers, birds, especially hummingbirds, and for some reason she loved pileated woodpeckers. And she loved people, and she loved Joe. Gravity did not confine her to Tennessee or Arizona. The world was large and exciting. God's creation had no limits. I think that Janet would tell you to be generous, be loving, and kind, and caring. She would tell you to make everybody a part of your life and assure them that they are important, that they are loved, and that they have great value. I'm going to close with a poem that I feel truly describes Janet and her life's journey. Two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel one and be one traveler. Long I stood and looked down one as far as I could to where it bent in the undergrowth. Then took the other as just as fair, and having perhaps a better claim, because it was grassy and wanted wear. Though as for that, the passing there had warned them really about the same, and that both that morning equally lay in leaves that no steps had trodden black. Oh, I kept the first for another day, yet knowing how way leads on to way, I doubted if I should ever come back. I shall be telling this with a sigh somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference.
A reading from Isaiah. But now thus says the Lord, He who created you, O Jacob, He who formed you, O Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
From Psalms. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long.
Reading from 1 Thessalonians. But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about those who have died, so that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have died. Therefore, encourage one another with these words.
The Holy Gospel according to John, the 14th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I'm going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
May be seated. Grace and peace be unto you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. As I prepared for today's service, where we honor the life and legacy of Janet McCarthy, I took a long look at the gospel reading that the family selected. It is part of the chapters in the Gospel of John that are most well known as Jesus' farewell discourse, his conversation with the disciples revealing what lies ahead in the Passion. But more than just an explanation of events soon to be at hand, this particular passage is at the heart, at its heart is Jesus saying goodbye. And that got me to thinking. What words do you use when you have to say goodbye? It depends on the situation, of course, if you are the one leaving or the one left behind. If this is forever, or just a temporary separation, if the time is right, or if it will ever be the right time, or if the time came too soon. It's also common to work ourselves up to saying goodbye, steeling ourselves against the grief that is to come, mapping out the steps that hopefully will help us accept what happens after the goodbye is said. And part of how we say goodbye represents how we choose to live, who we were in relationship that is now changed or is no longer, or how ready we are to let go. So as I prepared for today, I couldn't help but think about each of you, the family and friends of this beloved Janet McCarthy. What does it mean for you all today to say goodbye? As you heard, Janet was a woman of profound compassion. Even though I did not have the privilege of knowing her, I have heard from many of you about her servant's heart and how she loved deeply. She spent most of her life in service of others, lifting up those around her to be the best and the brightest. Her life of faith was deep and meaningful, and made a significant impact on the people of St. Timothy Lutheran Church and Desert Cross Lutheran Church, as well as so many more throughout her lifetime. What does it mean today to remember a woman of substance like Janet? How do you say goodbye? Certainly, if we look to the words from Jesus in our gospel lesson, they reveal what it means to say goodbye, both for Jesus and for the disciples. This is a rare pastoral exchange. We see Jesus as a pastor, as friend. This is Jesus at his most tender, most compassionate, because he knows just what is to come, both for him and for the disciples. These words are first and foremost words of comfort and hope, words of grief and farewell, words meant to remind and affirm. Yes, things will never be the same after Jesus and the disciples leave that meal together and cross the Kedron Valley to the garden. Yet goodbyes do not erase the past. In fact, goodbyes call to mind the past so that the future is possible. And while most people will focus on the end of this passage where Jesus says, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Wonderful, life-giving words, to be sure. I think the beginning of this passage is even more powerful. Words I need to hear. Words Jesus wants us all to hear. Jesus says, do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. believe in God and in Jesus. Trust in God and in Jesus. In other words, Jesus is saying, hold on to the relationship we had because my leaving does not change what was. In our passage today, Jesus says goodbye with tenderness and truthfulness.
Please rise. Thank you.
Chosen people together into one communion of saints in the body of Christ. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. God of mercy, grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to share the new life in Christ. God of mercy, give courage and faith to all who mourn, and assure and certain hope in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may have strength for the days ahead. God of mercy, grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith, that where their world groans in grief and pain, your Holy Spirit may lead us to bear witness to your light and life. God of mercy, help us in the midst of things we cannot understand to believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of life everlasting. God of mercy,
God of all grace, we give you thanks because by his death, our Savior Jesus Christ destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection, he opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Make us certain that because he lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, will be able to separate us from your love in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share the peace with one another. Savior Jesus Christ, who rose from the dead and in whom our hope of resurrection dawns. The sting of death has been removed by the glorious promise of his risen life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Thank you.
to us your will. He is your word, inseparable from you, through whom you created all things, and in whom you take delight. He is your word, sent from heaven to a virgin's womb. He there took on our nature and our lot, and was shown forth as your Son, born of the Holy Spirit and of the Virgin Mary. He, our Lord Jesus, fulfilled all your will and won for you a holy people. He stretched out his hands in suffering in order to free from suffering those who trust you. He is the one who handed over to a death he freely accepted in order to destroy death, to break the bonds of the evil one, to crush hell underfoot, to give light to the righteous, to establish his covenant, and to show forth the resurrection, taking bread and giving thanks to you, said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup. He gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Remembering then his death and resurrection, we take this bread and cup, giving you thanks that you have made us worthy to stand before you and to serve you as your priestly people. Send your spirits upon these gifts of your church, gathered into one, all who share this bread and wine. Fill us with your Holy Spirit to establish our faith in truth, that we may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ, through whom all glory and honor are yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit in your Holy Church, both now and forever.
Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Let us pray. God of abundance, with this bread of life and cup of salvation, you have united us with Christ, making us one with all your people. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Brief invitation from the family. We have a reception, a visitation reception following this. So please, the family will make their way to the Founders Hall, where there will be a place where you can do your visits and your wishes for the family. So please, once you leave here, instead of lingering in the narthex, please make your way towards Founders Hall. It's down the hall and to the left. So that's just a welcome from the family. So let us commend Janet to the mercy of God, our Maker and our Redeemer. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Janet. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in life.
Amen.
Let us go forth in peace in the name of Christ.